So we have been looking at the new covenant, and it involves the matter of grace. Now, grace, 'tis a charming sound. That's right. But how do you define grace? I think every human effort has failed, really. Grace. Somebody said, well, that's God's riches at Christ's expense. And I suppose that's reasonable. That's pretty good. When you think of it from God's perspective, certainly everything that comes to us on the basis of what Jesus has done. And that is grace. We can't add to that in any way. Some people have projected the idea that repentance is a sort of a work. Repentance isn't a work in the Bible. It's not defined as a work. And some people say, therefore, you are adding to grace. No, repentance is a part of grace. In order for us to be recipients of God's grace, now he has done everything, but in order for us to be recipients of his grace, there are certain conditions. And one of the conditions is that we repent of our sins. It's essential. And people will not find the outflowing or outpouring of grace unless they do repent of their sins. So there are certain conditions. And this is where so often the confusion arises. Now, some people then say, okay, you're adding to, and therefore repentance is an addition to the... No. Repentance is an essential part of our response to the totality of God's grace. It doesn't add to God's grace in any way, doesn't add to God's work, but it makes me a candidate to receive his grace. That's a confusing thing. And one of the issues of our time, brothers and sisters, is that, you know, we've got the internet. Now, the internet is a great thing if it's used properly. But it's also a diabolical thing. There are some terrible things on the internet. And people, and I think we in our fellowship must be careful what we send out as links, because the link sometimes has questionable material on it. And we have to be careful about that because, you know, children will pick up things and they'll say, well, it came from CWM or it came from somebody linked with CWM. And we can give people a justifiable reason for watching bad things, pornography, for example. Now, none of the stuff that we send out would have that sort of connotation, but the links can lead you into those sort of things. And this is where we've got to be very, very careful. Not only that, but now, because the internet is so prolific, there are people that we don't know anything about who set themselves up as teachers. And lots of our people slot into it, and they don't know anything about the background of the people, and they will take that stuff and promote it and create confusion. This was not what happened previously. I remember a former great in the Pentecostal movement, or people called him a great, it was Donald G. And he said, as he was coming to the end of his age, he said, I wouldn't like to be starting as a young minister today. And he started to outline the problems that young ministers had, which he didn't have. Well, now I don't know what he'd say if he was around today, but this is part of the problem. And especially when you're trying to present what you believe to be godly teaching, you can get bamboozled and bombarded with all sorts of other ideas. So just be careful about that type of thing. So I didn't intend to say that, but I've said it anyway. We are living in a time when the gospel is being confused. And it's right that we should be Bereans, no doubt about that. And so we can share ideas and discuss them. It's best probably to know a little bit about teachers before you start promoting them as teachers, because we don't know, and you may not know, their position. So we're living in that sort of a period, and we have to be aware of it. Having said that, we also challenge issues. and particularly in the area of the departure from the true gospel. We are opposed to the faith prosperity message, not because people cannot prosper, but because it shifts the emphasis away from the true gospel. It was not the thing that was preached in the New Testament. Throughout history, it wasn't the message. Today, it has become the dominant message, particularly in Pentecostal and charismatic circles. And so we have to be careful about these things. So today we're looking at another aspect of the new covenant. Remember, of course, we'll come back to this again. We'll keep on coming back to this. The new covenant essentially was made with Israel. Jeremiah 31, the time will come when I will make a new covenant with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. That is very, very specific. And it has to be seen in that context. However, there are, of course, enormous blessings which flow over to everybody within the kingdom of the Lord Jesus Christ. And that's some of the things I want to address this morning. Our main text, which we will come back to shortly, we'll depart from it for a while, but we'll come back to it, and the passage will be 2 Corinthians chapter 4, from verse 17 through to chapter 6, verse 1. So you can get ready and look that up. But our text is, therefore, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. Some versions say new creation. Because you have the mighty in the minute. You have the cosmos in the crucible. You have creation in the creature. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creature, of course. But he is a new creation. The Creator God has formed something, and that becomes a microcosm of the intention of God throughout the whole church of Jesus Christ. If any man be in Christ, that's the key. In Christ is the answer to every theological dilemma. In Christ. I once had a series of books, two books I think it was, called In the Sun, Life in the Sun and Security in the Sun. And it brought out some, I don't know if I read the books totally, but the concept anyway gripped me. Life in the sun, our life is in the sun. He that hath the Son hath life. And he that hath not the Son of God hath not life, but the wrath of God abideth in him. And so, life in the Son, security in the Son. People debate about eternal security. Well, I thank God I am secure, but it's only in the Son. Is it possible to come outside of the Son? Yes. Read the New Testament. Peter warns about the dog returning to its vomit. And the sow to its wallowing again in the mire. If people are living in sin and they're pointing back to an experience when they supposedly found Christ and they are glorying in a false sense of security. Because we're only secure in Christ. And we must examine ourselves. Paul says in one place, examine yourselves to see if you're in the faith. He's writing to Christians. So there has to be that constant examination and constant application. And this is where so much is getting confused today. Now, there's a very, very clever ploy that is being used today. As soon as some of these people who do not preach the full gospel are being challenged, they revert to the issue that you address. And they say, there you are, and they make a statement about, for example, repentance. Joseph Prince has done it. Brian Houston has done it. Because they're conscious of the criticisms. But if you examine what they say, they do not present true repentance. Not Bible repentance, anyway. In a sense, it is what Paul talked about, a repentance to be repented of. Okay, let's go. I've been looking at the next issue of CETF, and I was impressed with the fact that just before Christmas, the Golden City was turned into a white city. So I wrote to the editor of Israel Today, and I said, is this normal? Because I was thinking about something. It'll be the part of my editorial in the next issue of CETF. Job said many years ago, have you entered into the treasures of the snow? Which I have reserved against the time of trouble, against the day of battle and war. The war is building up. It's building up. So I was very, very interested to see if this was normal. I got a letter back, and they said, Shalom, Reverend Powell. You are welcome to use some of our snow photos with credit given to Israel Today. Jerusalem will see at least some snow almost every winter. However, the kind of snow we received this year, about 30 centimeters in some areas, only occurs once every 5 to 10 years. Typically, the snow does not come in December, but rather January and February. Blessings from Jerusalem, Ryan Jones, Israel Today. Interesting. Have you entered into the treasures of the snow, which I have reserved against the time of trouble, against the day of battle and war? There have been two notable occasions in history when absolutely invincible armies have been routed by the snow. Napoleon, he was marching on Russia, and he was invincible, going to triumph. His armies were far superior to any enemy's forces. Guess what? The snow came. And he was routed. It happened with Hitler. He marched on Russia with 3.3 million troops. And he made a premature announcement to all his people on radio. He said, "We are about to take the enemy. The Reich will be 3 times bigger than when I came to office. Nothing can stand in our way." The snow came. 750,000 Germans lay dead in the snow. Have you entered into the treasures of the snow, which I have reserved against the time of trouble, against the day of battle and war? Now, the other thing that was occupying my mind, and we'll see it in a moment, was a phrase that came to me. The devil's in the detail. We'll have a look at that again in a moment. This is Jerusalem. The armies are surrounding Jerusalem. I'm not saying that, you know, this is the way it's going to go. I'm not sure. But it could. The devil's in the detail. What detail there is in snow? Interestingly, that expression didn't appear until about 1975. You don't find it anywhere in print until about 1975. It's predicated upon another statement. That idiom first appeared in print in 1975, according to the encyclopedia, the Wikipedia thing. God is in the detail was the forerunner of it. Strange that we change from God to devil, isn't it? God is in the detail appeared in the mid-1800s. In French, Jean-Claude, you'll be pleased to know, first. Now, you better pronounce this. Le bon Dieu est dans le détail. Which I think, in English, says the good God is in the detail. Doesn't it show something of the drift of society? Away from perceiving that God is in the detail, to now looking, and of course, the idiom has a sense of meaning, which I think I've got to somewhere, again from the Wikipedia. The devil is in the detail refers to a catch or mysterious element hidden in the details. And then it goes on, the idiom, the devil is in the detail, derives from the earlier phrase, God is in the detail, expressing the idea that whatever one does should be done thoroughly. That is, details are important. I want to come back to that and see that in regard to the Bible. Details are important. This original idiom has been attributed to a number of different individuals, most notably to a German-born architect, and so on. That is the idiom, God is in the detail. But just for a moment, stay with this concept of the shift from the emphasis upon God to the emphasis upon the devil in today's society. Paul Harvey, a noted radio announcer in 1966, put out a statement which has come back up and is now circulating the internet. If I were the devil.
If I were the devil. If I were the devil. If I were the prince of darkness, I'd want to engulf the whole world in darkness, and I'd have a third of its real estate and four-fifths of its population, but I wouldn't be happy until I had seized the ripest apple on the tree, thee. So I'd set about, however necessary, to take over the United States. I'd subvert the churches first. I'd begin with a campaign of whispers. With the wisdom of a serpent, I would whisper to you as I whispered to Eve, do as you please. To the young, I would whisper that the Bible is a myth. I would convince them that man created God instead of the other way around. I would confide that what's bad is good and what's good is square. And the old I would teach to pray after me, our Father, which art in Washington. And then I'd get organized. I'd educate authors in how to make lurid literature exciting so that anything else would appear dull and uninteresting. I'd threaten TV with dirtier movies, and vice versa. I'd peddle narcotics to whom I could. I'd sell alcohol to ladies and gentlemen of distinction. I'd tranquilize the rest with pills. If I were the devil, I'd soon have families at war with themselves, churches at war with themselves, and nations at war with themselves, until each in its turn was consumed. And with promises of higher ratings, I'd have mesmerizing media fanning the flames. If I were the devil, I would encourage schools to refine young intellects, but neglect to discipline emotions. Just let those run wild. Until before you knew it, you'd have to have drug-sniffing dogs and metal detectors at every schoolhouse door. Within a decade, I'd have prisons overflowing. I'd have judges promoting pornography. Soon I could evict God from the courthouse, then from the schoolhouse, and then from the houses of Congress. And in his own churches, I would substitute psychology for religion and deify science. I would lure priests and pastors into misusing boys and girls and church money. If I were the devil, I'd make the symbol of Easter an egg and the symbol of Christmas a bottle. If I were the devil, I'd take from those who have and give to those who wanted until I had killed the incentive of the ambitious. And what'll you bet? I couldn't get whole states to promote gambling as the way to get rich. I would caution against extremes in hard work, in patriotism, in moral conduct. I would convince the young that marriage is old-fashioned, that swinging is more fun, that what you see on TV is the way to be. And thus I could undress you in public, and I could lure you into bed with diseases for which there is no cure. In other words, if I were the devil, I'd just keep right on doing what he's doing.
Paul Harvey.
47 years ago, 1966, most of it. Some sort of conjecture that's been updated a little bit, but I mean, that same voice is there. I don't know. But that's what's happening, isn't it? And really, you know, man doesn't have the solution. Now, we've got to the point where the Bible talks about there being no way out, no answer. That's the problem. The leaders don't have an answer because it's always self-interest. Take, for example, now the big issue in America, which is the gun lobby. I thought this was rather humorous. Can you pick it up? There he is, right in the middle. He says there's too many guns being used to protect other lives besides mine. I know there's different ways of looking at the issue. But really, when it's all selfish. It's all self. Everything. The devil's in the detail. But from our perspective, God is in the detail. That's what I want to try and leave with you this morning. I know it's a bit different what we're doing. The outworking of the new covenant. Let's have a look at the detail. Jeremiah 31:31, behold, the days come, saith the Lord, that I will make a new covenant, and now very specific, with the house of Israel and with the house of Judah. Tracing through the Bible, there are several covenants. There's the Adamic covenant. Very simple. God said, in the day that you eat thereof, dying, you will die. Man didn't enter into it and say, well, yeah, I'm going to agree with that covenant. I mean, it was just there. It was just, you know, man was obliged to obey. And if he didn't, he would reap the consequences. There are other covenants. There's the Abrahamic covenant. And here's where a lot of the confusion arises. People confuse the Abrahamic covenant with the Old Covenant. They're different. The Old Covenant is the Mosaic covenant. We'll see it. It's all here. Remember, God is in the detail. But he says, I'm going to make a new covenant. Is the old covenant, but I'm going to make a new covenant. The new covenant does not supersede the Abrahamic covenant. They are two different things. The new covenant supersedes the old covenant. And it's made with the house of Judah and the house of Israel. Verse 32. Remember, God is in the detail. So I've emphasized the verse. 32. Not according to the covenant that I made with their fathers. What covenant is he talking about? In the day that I took them by the hand to bring them out of the land of Egypt. This is not the Abrahamic covenant. The Abrahamic covenant was God taking Abram into Egypt, not out of Egypt. into Canaan. And then his forebears, his descendants into Egypt. This is the covenant. It's going to be different from the covenant that I made with the people when I brought them out of Egypt, which my covenant they broke. Although I was married to them, I was a husband to them, and I wouldn't let them go, saith the Lord. And knowing that God is in the detail, I think that little word said is wrong there. It should be saith. Have a look at the King James. The online Bible has made some changes. Interesting. I didn't discover this until I looked at the detail. God is saying, it's not something that he said back there. It's says the Lord. It's in the present. Verse 32. Okay, so the two covenants that are presented here is the old covenant, and in contrast, here is the new covenant. Verse 33. But this shall be the covenant that I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and will be their God, and they shall be my people. Shows how the devil is in the detail, doesn't it? I changed that word David said to Seth twice on my computer, but the computer wouldn't take it. Must have been reverting to its spell check or something. So maybe the devil is in the detail after all. Sorry. I will make with the house of Israel, but this is the covenant I will make with the house of Israel after those days, saith the Lord. I will put my law in their inward parts and write it in their hearts, and I will be their God, and they shall be my people. So now this is the new covenant. Verse 34, and they shall teach no more every man his neighbor and every man his brother, saying, know the Lord, for they shall all know me. From the least of them to the greatest of them, saith the Lord, for I will forgive their iniquity. The Seth got changed there, all right. For I will forgive their iniquity, and I will remember their sin no more. Has that happened? No. Have we arrived at a point, either here or in Israel, where people don't need to propagate the gospel? Where people don't need to tell their brother, their neighbor, know the Lord? No. So what is the new covenant? Here is a comprehensive view of the new covenant, and it's outworking. There is the present, there is the future. This is why I am absolutely convinced that there's got to be a millennium. There's got to be a millennial reign of Christ. And during that time, there will be no need to tell everyone to know the Lord. They'll all know him. Not now. Okay, let's move on. A statement regarding the Israel of God. It's a term which is used only once in the New Testament. And it's an important term. And it's right for us to examine and decide who is the Israel of God. Because in many instances, the church today is saying that Israel, the natural people, whoever you consider them to be, the ethnic people, are finished. And it's all to do with the church now. So that the Israel of God is the church. Looking at the Bible contextually, in the context, that cannot possibly be the case. Let me direct you to the verse. It's in Galatians chapter 6, verse 16. And as many as walk according to this rule, peace be on them and mercy and on the Israel of God. Two classes of people. Peace be on them and on these. On them and on these. Now, how do we establish who the them are and who the these are? Well, the previous verses. Verses 14 and 15. But God forbid that I should glory, save in the cross of our Lord Jesus Christ, by whom the world is crucified to me and I to the world. For in Christ Jesus, neither circumcision avails anything nor uncircumcision, but a new creature. The them, in the way I presented it, are those who walk according to this rule. What rule? The rule of being crucified with Christ. That's the church, isn't it? That's God's people. Now, we don't all aspire or try or achieve that objective of being actually crucified with Christ, but that is the intention, and that determines the church. So, Paul says, peace be upon them, that is the church, and upon the Israel of God. Who are the Israel of God? Those who were following circumcision. Now, Paul says in Romans 9 to 11, when he is dealing with his own people, and I think it's the Jewish state, there may be others who will have different views on that, but he's dealing with his own people, and he says, I could wish myself to be accursed for the salvation of my own people. Those who are my flesh and blood. He's talking about his Jewish heritage. He's talking about the people that he relates to. He says, because I wish above all else that they might be saved. And then he gives a very, very strong warning to the church in Romans chapters 9 to 11. He said, look, don't glory over the natural branches. Be careful. Because if God deals with them and cuts them off, don't forget he can cut you off also. Remember that you were grafted in. But be careful, don't glory over the natural branch. So he's again coming back to these two sort of concepts. The church. So the point I just want to make, and I'm not getting to any other areas of controversy, but this one, that the Israel of God cannot be the church of Jesus Christ. It must be an ethnic people of some sort. For me, it is the Jewish nation. And I think there's adequate proof of that. The outworking of the new covenant is our main concept. 2 Corinthians 5:17, therefore if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. All things are passed away. Behold, all things are become new. One rendering says, let him be a new creature. Now, I don't think that's a very good rendering, personally. I think the other rendering is much better and it is stronger and it is more accurate to the text. But nevertheless, you cannot get away from the idea that in the New Testament, we are obliged to bring forth works which are meet for repentance, which demonstrate that we have indeed been made a new creature in Christ Jesus. It's no good saying, I'm a new creature in Christ, if you're not a new creature in Christ, right? So the other emphasis is important. Let him be a new creature. If any man be in Christ, let him be a new creature. If we're still clinging to our sins, our selfishness, all of these other things, and still saying we are new creatures in Christ because we're saved, and taking that position that it's all to do with God and nothing to do with us, which tends to be the modern message today. Grace, as it's presented by the popular preachers today, without mentioning specific names, although I've already mentioned them, but they are presenting the idea that grace is all of God and nothing of us. Where do you get that idea from? It's predicated upon the idea that grace is unmerited favor. No. Mercy is unmerited favor. God shows mercy, thank God. He has provided a propitiation for all our sins. But grace is something more than that. Grace is a divine dynamic which brings about a change. Now, if there is no change, there is no grace. So, go back to the other and say, if any man be in Christ, let him be a new creature. Are you a new creature? Have old things passed away? Have new things become? Well, even if you take the idea that it's progressive, which I think it is, if any man be in Christ, he is a new creature. He starts with a new creation, but then it's developed through sanctification. As we adopt the principles of God and understand the character of God and the nature of God, I am more convinced than ever that an understanding of the character and nature of God is basic to all good theology. If you don't understand that, you don't understand anything. In Mr. What's his name's message, he says repentance is everywhere in the Old Testament. Well, hang on. I don't think the word repentance appears very many times in the Old Testament. It appears far more times in the New Testament. Repentance is essentially a New Testament concept. And then he sort of, you know, with his eloquence and his very wonderful charismatic appeal, he says, John the Baptist came preaching repentance. And then he alludes to something and he takes a verse and he says, since John the Baptist, the kingdom of God is preached. But he makes John the Baptist fit into the old and not into the new. Whereas John the Baptist is a transitional character. And don't forget that Jesus took up exactly the same message as John. Not only did John preach repentance, but Jesus preached repentance. And all through the New Testament, you have the preaching of repentance. Why? Because without repentance, there is no grace. Not insofar as its transmission to me is concerned. It's there potentially, of course. But I have to tap into it. How do I tap into it? I tap into it through repentance. And if I do not repent, then his salvation will not become mine. As Christians, we cannot live as we wish. We have to be changed people. And we have to be constantly changed into the image of his Son more and more every day. Philippians 3:4 says, though I might also have confidence in the flesh, if any other man thinks that he has whereof he might trust in the flesh, I more. Paul keeps on saying, I more. Paul is the great sort of touchstone in history insofar as doctrine and character and everything is concerned. You'll never find a greater Christian than Paul. He probably died when he was in his 50s. Any of you in your 50s? Look out. I've gone a bit beyond that now. So I don't have to look out anymore. Paul, he says, look, these people who glory in whatever, you know. And I want to come back to that in a moment. 1 Corinthians 11:30. If I must needs glory, I will glory in the things which concern my infirmities. Nothing about destined to reign here, is there? Nothing about I am a king's kid here. And as a king's kid, I'll ride over everybody roughshod. Nothing. If I'm going to glory in anything, I won't glory in my revelation. I won't glory in my achievements. I won't even glory in my accomplishments. I will glory of the things which concern my infirmities. And boy, if you look at those infirmities, my oh my. 1 Corinthians 4:8. Now you are full. Now you are rich. You have reigned as kings without us. And I would to God you did reign, that we also might reign with you. Doesn't that sound familiar? Destined to reign, eh? Yeah, we are. But you've got to see the difference between the now and the then. You've got to see the difference between the here and the hereafter. You've got to see the difference between the present and the future. And that's what I want to see as we go into this passage. 2 Corinthians 4 and 5 particularly. Just have a look at this as we go through. I'll read it. But watch for these points. Watch for the two groups of people. Those who are lost and those who are saved. Watch for the two periods of time, now and then. And finally, watch for what Jacob Prash calls the unrealized eschatology. Now and yet not now. The fact that things are happening and yet they have yet to be fulfilled. This is particularly so with regard to some of the things that we've been addressing recently in respect of the new covenant. The kingdom of God. What is the kingdom of God? Well, the kingdom of God is many things. Jesus said the kingdom of God is within you, among you, in your midst. That's one aspect of the kingdom. Will you, Lord, at this time restore the kingdom to Israel? Future. Jesus didn't say, like some of the modern preachers would like him to have said, oh no, there's not going to be any fulfillment of the kingdom to Israel. He didn't say that. And in avoiding that issue and not saying anything about it, he would be a hypocrite if it were not true that God will restore the kingdom to Israel. All that he said was, it's not for you to know the time or the seasons. In other words, it will happen in God's timing, but it's not for you to know the timing. So there is a future kingdom. When we pray, Our Father which art in heaven, thy kingdom come, thy will be done on earth as it is in heaven. We're embracing the whole of this. We're embracing the fact that we would like to see God's kingdom come today, more and more in my life, so that I have more of his joy, more of his peace, more of his blessing, more of his prosperity, not my prosperity, but his prosperity. But I'm also praying that his kingdom will come in the ultimate sense, that Jesus Christ will return. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done. It's unrealized eschatology. It's progressive. It's going on all the time. Watch for this as we go down through the passage of Scripture. And just to make the point, in case I forget, the two groups of people, very clearly shown in this passage in verse 15. We'll come to it in a moment as I read. And that he died for all. Who did Christ die for? Christ died for all. Now, you can't just say all of us. So it's again exclusive and it doesn't involve the whole world. You can't do that because of what follows. That they which live should not live unto themselves. So there's two groups of people clearly here. This deals the death blow to the idea of limited atonement. The absolute death toll to it. One of the essentials of the so-called Calvinistic doctrines. Although other groups embrace it in varying degrees as well. It deals the death blow to it. That Christ only died for the elect. No. He died for all. Whosoever will may come. Whosoever will. He died for all. But there is an elect group. What are they? They are those who have been changed, who should not now live unto themselves, but unto him who died and who rose again. If any man be in Christ, he is a new creation. Old things have passed away. Okay, with that in mind, with those things before us, let me read. For our light affliction, verse 17 of 2 Corinthians 4, which is but for a moment. Now and then, in contrast, working for us a far more exceeding and eternal weight of glory. Light affliction? Really? Have a look at 2 Corinthians 11, verse 21. I speak as concerning reproach. We get a bit of persecution, it's nothing. Bit of criticism. What does that matter? I speak as concerning reproach, as though we had been weak. Howbeit, whereinsoever any is bold, I speak foolishly, I am bold also. Are they Hebrews? So am I. Are they Israelites? So am I. Are they the seed of Abraham? So am I. Are they ministers of Christ? I speak as a fool. I am more. There's that word again. In labors more abundant. In stripes above measure. In prisons more frequent. In deaths oft. Of the Jews, 5 times received I 40 stripes, save one. 39 stripes. 3 times was I beaten with rods. Incidentally, you know, of Christ, there was this view at one time that Christ received his chastisement for our healing. In fact, Yonggi Cho preaches this. And then he died for our sins. And one man went so far as to say that Christ, by his 39 stripes, dealt with all the 39 major diseases in the human race. Well, I don't think any medical person who is worth his salt would tell you there's 39 major diseases. But the other problem is Christ didn't have 39 stripes. The 39 stripes related to the Jewish law. It was illegal to beat a Jew more than 39 times, but not the Romans. Christ did not suffer at the hands of the Jews. Christ suffered at the hands of the Romans. And they took that cruel whip with its leaded weights at the end. And they lacerated his body to such an extent that it is described prophetically as being like a plowed field. No man suffered like my blessed Savior. Don't try and reduce it to that, to dealing with a medical condition. The crucifixion was all part and parcel of the one thing. And he dealt with the sin question once and for all. Hallelujah. By his death and by his stripes and through his resurrection. And that is the truth of the new covenant. And that is why grace is so marvelous. Paul said, I suffered at the hands of the Jews. And he says, 3 times I was beaten with the rods. Once I was stoned. 3 times I suffered shipwreck. A night and a day I have been in the deep, in journeyings often, in perils of waters, in perils of robbers, in perils of my own countrymen, in perils by the heathen, in perils in the city, in perils in the wilderness, in perils in the sea, in perils among false brethren, in weariness and painfulness, in watchings often, in hunger and thirst, in fastings often, in cold and naked. I know nothing about that. What about you? Besides those things that are without, that which cometh upon me daily, the care of all the churches. Well, a little bit of that, but not like Paul, who is weak, and I am not weak. Who is offended, and I burn not. If I must needs glory, I will glory of the things which concern my infirmities. Not of my position or even my destiny in Christ, but of my infirmities. Okay, let's read on. 2 Corinthians 4. While we look not at the things which are seen, here's the two areas, the now and the hereafter, but at the things which are not seen. For the things which are seen are temporal, but the things which are not seen are eternal. For we know that if our earthly house of this tabernacle were dissolved, we have a building of God and house not made with hands, eternal in the heavens. For in this we groan, earnestly desiring to be clothed upon with our house which is from heaven. If so be that being clothed, we shall not be found naked. For we that are in this tabernacle do groan, being burdened, not for that which we would be unclothed, but clothed upon that mortality. Only God is immortal, as we heard. That mortality might be swallowed up of life. Now he that hath wrought us for the selfsame thing is God, who hath given us the earnest of the Spirit. Notice this, just as we're going through, the earnest of the Spirit. We haven't got all of the Spirit now. Only Christ had the whole Holy Spirit without measure. We've only got the earnest, but I tell you, if it's so great with the earnest, what's it going to be when we get the full dose? Hallelujah. The limited amount of the Spirit. This is where it's all at. It's by the Holy Ghost that things are done. And you cannot have the Holy Spirit actually at work if error is being preached. It can only work where there is truth, because he is the Spirit of truth. Well, you read the rest of it. I was going to go through it, but it's all there. Read it when you get home. But notice also, as we've gone through, the two groups of people, it's all there, keeps on recurring. Also the two periods of time, and eternity. We live in time. God dwells in eternity. I remember seeing the Moody Bible Institute film called Time and Eternity, where they used clever devices through photographic ingenuity to show the difference between our time as we measure it and even within our context, the elongating of time, where they could show a day in a few moments from sunrise to sunset, and they could show the dropping of dew from a petal of a flower down to the ground, and it seemed to take eternity to drop. Because you see, time is, it relates to us, but eternity is where God dwells. Time and eternity. Remember the little ditty where a man comes and says, God, what's a year to you? And God says, a second. And then he says, and what's $1 million to you? And God says, a penny. And so the man says, can I have a penny? And God says, yes, but you have to wait a second. Time and eternity. Our time. His time. C.T. Studd. Brilliant sportsman. Nothing wrong with sport. I hope Federer wins the Australian Open. I better not say I'm glad he beat Tomac, but There's nothing wrong with sport. But it's passing. Some of the great sportsmen who earned fabulous money end up bankrupt. But that's not the issue. Everything they get, they've got to leave behind. All the plaudits of men, everything. Everything. C.T. Studd, brilliant cricketer, very, very wealthy man, suddenly was impacted with the gospel of Christ, and he said, "If God be Christ, if Christ be God and died for me, then no sacrifice that I can make for him can be too great." He gave away his fortune, turned away from his cricket career, became a missionary, left behind him far more than he would have ever left behind if he hadn't gone that course. He left behind him the great WEC missionary organization, which boasted missionaries in practically every country in the world at one time. If Christ be God and died for you, then no sacrifice that you can make for him can be too great. Take with the Ecuador missionaries. The story of them impacted me when I was a young man. They went down into the Amazon, the jungle, to take the message to a tribe that had never heard the gospel. They were warned not to go. They took a small plane and they flew in. At first, it seemed that the natives of that part were friendly. They gathered around them. But they'd never seen a white man before. And after a while, they turned against them and killed them all. What a waste. What a waste. But in the diary of one of those Ecuador missionaries, there was found this statement. "He is no fool who loses something he cannot keep to gain something he cannot lose. He is no fool who loses something he cannot keep. Natural life, we cannot keep it. To gain something we cannot lose. Eternal life, we will never lose it." Hallelujah. And that eternal reward. Unrealized eschatology now, and yet not now. The covenant, the new covenant, didn't replace the Abrahamic covenant. The Abrahamic covenant is still in force. It will find its outworking. How? I don't know. How God will protect Jerusalem when ultimately it is surrounded by all enemies. No allies. Not even America. Not even Britain. Everyone will turn against them. How he will protect them, I do not know. God is in the detail. Could it be the snow? Could this be a sort of a omen of God saying, "Look out. I control the weather. You may have your armaments. You may join against them. But there will come a day when I will go out to fight for them as I did of old, because the Abrahamic covenant has not and never will be replaced." What about us? Thank God the grace of God reaches out to us. "I will make a new covenant. I will make a new covenant." And Jesus stood there and he broke that bread and he took that wine and he said, "This is my body, which is broken for you. This is my blood, which is shed for you. The cup of the new covenant, which is for us all. Hallelujah. Who embrace his grace and turn to him in obedience and in faith. Hallelujah. Just one thing to reflect on. Some people say that obedience and faith are two different things. No, they're not. If you look up the meaning of the word faith, you'll find that involved in faith is always obedience. Because faith is not just a mental assent. It's not just me agreeing to something. Faith is a commitment. And that commitment always involves the will. That's why love, in the sense of divine love, is never a mere emotion. It's an act of the will. That's why God can command us to love one another. If it was merely emotional, we could say, oh, well, I could love that one, but I can't love the other. God says, love one another. It's a command. And it's an act of our will to do it. The same thing with God. That is why also love is not unconditional. Never. We've bought the idea that God's love is unconditional. He loves me no matter what I do. No, that's not true. That is not true. It's not biblical. It was unconditional in its beginning because God is love. He's the essence of love. And so irrespective of what state I was in, he loved me. But when I come to him, he requires certain things of me in order for his love to continue to be outpoured to me. The same thing with grace. The same thing with love. The same thing with faith. Faith and obedience are not in contrast one with the other. The Bible says Abram believed God. It also said Abram obeyed God. So faith and obedience work together. And they, and only they, working together, produce the benefits of the gospel of grace. The gospel of the new covenant. Hallelujah. Let's pray. Lord, we thank you for bringing us together. We thank you for your word. We thank you for the sense of the presence of God with us. Lord, I pray that you will keep us ever true to you. Save us from being superficial people, Lord. Help us to know your truth, because the truth will set us free. Blessed be your wonderful name. And help us to share this marvelous message of the love of God and the grace of God and the blessings of the new covenant to those who will embrace you and your salvation and your greatness. We pray in Jesus' name.